mistakes, but still I have found I may stumble and fall, but through it all, my God is still good. Because mercy still flows from the palm of His hand, He gives me grace, helps me to stand. And although He knows how unworthy I am, my God is still good. Your hymnal tonight, turn to page 343, draw me nearer to the cross. As we stand together tonight, sing the first, second, and last 343 in your church hymnal.
Every day, Lord, we thank you for that, Lord. If there's some lost soul here tonight, Lord, I pray that they'll ask on you, Lord, to come into their heart and not leave here without knowing you as their personal Savior, Lord. I pray, ask your hand on the preacher tonight. Pray, God, that you lead, guide, and direct him and use us, Lord. We thank you for everything that's done. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen. Shake hands now. Turn around and smile and wave at somebody before you are seated tonight. It's good to see this good-looking crowd on a Wednesday night. We want to pray for the junior church. It started back up tonight.
junior church in the other building with Brother Braden Smith. And so you pray for Braden and all the kids. We want to welcome you into the service. If you're visiting with us for the first time tonight, would you lift up your hand and let the ushers find you, and you fill out that card, drop it in the offering bag as it passes by. We want to pray for our pastor and his wife continually. They are still sick and still pretty weak, and so just continue to pray for them. Then Ronnie Shackelford, he had back surgery today. We went over and prayed with him, and he came out of that surgery doing well. Everything was a success, is what they said, so just pray for him. And Miss Brenda Hawkins, they took her to the hospital tonight with some heart issues, and so they wanted to mention Miss Brenda. And then Crystal Burkett, a friend that we went to high school with, found out she has cancer, terminal cancer, and so just pray for her. There'll be no Truth for Youth this week due to the wedding, and so no Truth for Youth this week. And then the Cultivate Marriage Conference, September the 15th through the 17th. It's $100 per person. You can sign up in the lobby. That's our personal conference. And then also the Cage Cove sign-ups for young people. They're out in the lobby with also the visitor, Cage Cove information, the list, and the waiver. So please pick that up and sign up so we can go ahead and start getting the tents gathered. Jeremy and his youth group will be coming down from Emmanuel, Swansboro, to join us at Cage Cove this year. So we're going to have a good packed house at Cage Cove, so you pray for us. And we'll be saying more about that as we get closer, about y'all bringing the Debbie cakes like you always do. We'll be announcing that probably in the middle of June. Ushers, you come. We'll receive the offering tonight for the church sign. I have a preliminary drawing of it, but I didn't like the color on the bottom, so he's changing that up. We have a beautiful sign he's designed us. We hope to have that picture out for you in another week or two so you can look at it out in the lobby. Brother Rick, would you lead us in prayer, please?
Kind and gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, thank you once again, Lord, for allowing us back in your house, Lord. Amen. Lord, we thank you for what the Spirit's already been felt here tonight, Lord. We pray, Lord, that you would just have your will and way in this service tonight, Lord. Touch Sammy and the choir and the musicians, Lord, and bless them, Lord, as they sing for your glory. Lord, be with them down in the other church, for the junior church, Lord. I pray, Lord, that you would just touch them, Lord. Lord, give them fruits for their labor down there, and bless them, Lord. Be with all those that couldn't be here tonight, Lord, especially with Miss Ann and Preacher Sammy, Lord. I pray, Lord, that you'd touch them in a special way, Amen. Lord. Strengthen them, Lord. Heal them according to thy will, Amen. Lord. Lord, watch over Brother Ronnie, Lord. I pray, Lord, that you would touch him, Lord, and heal him, Lord, and get him back to us, Lord. Lord, everyone else is sick and suffering, Lord. I pray that you'd touch them according to your will, Lord. Lord, have your will tonight, Lord, with the preaching. Be with Sammy Jr. as he breaks the bread of life, Lord. I pray, Lord, that you would touch him tonight, Lord. Lift him up and strengthen him, Lord. Give him what we stand most in need of hearing, Lord. Bless this offering. For it's in the name of Jesus we do ask. Amen.
Amen. Thank you.
Thank you.
was filled with danger. I felt alone. The enemy had singled me out to do me wrong. And when he drew near, my heart filled with fear. Then I heard someone dear calling me to his side. And I ran under his wings. There he covered me, and now I can sing. And the enemy still looks for me, but what he can't see is that I'm under my Lord's wings. Under his wings. Thunder rolled, dark clouds hung low. I was out in a storm, shivering in the coldness there. No safe retreat. And there were strong winds. Would this be my end? And then I heard my friend calling me to his side. And I ran under his wings. There he covered me. The storm still rages, but in the rock of ages, I'm resting warmly here under my Lord's wings. Under his wings. And there he covered me, and now I can sing.
There we go. Amen. If you take your Bibles tonight, let me get to where I am. I got me all teary-eyed. But I love that song. I love to hear them sing it. I'm under his wings. Hallelujah. Take your Bibles and turn to the book of Isaiah tonight. Isaiah chapter 41. Isaiah chapter 41. And it's been an honor to preach for my father. But I know y'all are all wanting him back, and so do I, dear lady in the church tonight. She said, you're doing a fine job, but I just miss my pastor. I said, I feel the same way. And you're talking about loneliness since Jeremy left me. And I know Jeremy always goes back and watches. That's why I'm telling him that. But Jeremy left, and then now Dad's been gone sick. I've been by myself at the church all week. And most people would say that would be awesome. Man, it's lonely around here. And that old church in City View was haunted. I mean, you could get the stories from Dad and Jim and all the different stories of creaking and all the different things. But I decided to come in here in the dark like Dad, since Dad, it worked for Dad. I got on that front row, and I'm just going to be real honest. While praying, I had to look around a couple times because there's some noises comes out of this place. And so I'm wanting Dad to come back real soon because it gets scary around here too. No, but I do appreciate him allowing me to fill in for him while he's under the weather. And we're praying for his quick return. The Bible says here, I want to start reading in verse 17 of chapter 41 of Isaiah. Isaiah 41:17, the Bible says, when the poor and needy seek water, and there is none, and their tongue faileth for thirst, I, the Lord, will hear them. I, the God of Israel, will not forsake them. I will open up rivers in high places and fountains in the midst of the valleys. I will make the wilderness a pool of water and the dry land springs of water. I will plant in the wilderness the cedar, the shittah tree, and the myrtle, and the oil tree. I will set in the desert the fir tree and the pine and the box tree together, that they may see and know and consider and understand together that the hand of the Lord hath done this, and the Holy One of Israel hath created it. God speaking to the children of Israel in their low time, because they have just come out of bondage and now they're in bondage again, and now they've been coming out of this type of bondage. And God, they think that everything is distraught, but God mentions some things here like the shittah tree and the cedar tree and the myrtle and the oil tree and different ones, the pine, the box. None of those grow in the wilderness. None of those have the wherewithal to grow in a desert place. But God said, you don't believe I can provide a table in the wilderness for you and for my people and meet your need when no one else can? I'm going to make trees grow where trees are not supposed to grow. And I'm going to cause waters not just to come out of low places, but waters to come out of high places. Have you ever been up on the top of some great mountain? We go to Cades Cove and there'll be a river running off the top of the mountain coming down, and it runs that way all of the time. I'm always amazed by that, how that river continually runs. But I'm here to tell you there's a God behind all of that. And when God can make the river run on the top of the mountain, I like what he says, and this is what I want to preach on. And also fountains in the midst of the valley. Fountains. I'm going to cause fountains to come up in the midst of the valley. Now I want to move over. You don't have to turn, but Psalms 36. Psalms 36 says this in verse 7, how excellent is thy loving kindness. Old David knew what he was talking about. O God, therefore the children of men put their trust under the shadow of thy wings, as they just sang about. They shall be abundantly satisfied with the fatness of thy house, and thou shalt make them drink the river of thy pleasures. For with thee is the fountain of life. Get that now. For with thee is the fountain of life. In thy light shall we see light. O continue thy loving kindness unto them that know thee, and thy righteousness to the upright in heart. I want to go back now to Isaiah, but I want to preach on this subject for a moment on fountains in the valleys. Fountains in the valleys. None of us are not familiar with what the valley is. But I remember Harold Aiken. Many of you may remember an old member of mine. Harold and Florine Aiken used to sit here. Both passed away. But they were my shut-ins when I first came to work here. But he wrote me a song. I have the paper. I don't have the tune. So therefore, I've never been able to sing it because I don't have a tune. Lyle, maybe you can help me with that one of these days. But he wrote me a song, and the title of the song is, If it wasn't for the valleys, there couldn't be any mountaintops. If there wasn't for the valley, you'd never have a mountaintop. It would just all be mountains. But between every mountaintop, there is a valley. And if you know anything about this Christian life, every single one of us walk through the valley one time or another in our Christian life. The valley's not an easy place, but yet we all could go to the valley. But I'm glad what God says here, that even in the valleys, I will open up rivers in high places and fountains in the midst of the valley. Now, what God literally promised Israel here in the context, He promises to all of us on this journey below here in our life. You don't need counseling. You don't need special attention in your valley. All you need is the Word of God. Now, I'm telling you, that helps. Friends help in the valley. Church helps in the valley. Pastors help in the valley. But I'm here to tell you, none of those can bring you through the valley. You want to get through the valley, depend upon God, and He'll bring you a fountain in the middle of your valley. God is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And what He did for Israel in the valley, He can do for us as well. Do y'all believe that tonight? I believe God is still the same. And I believe He can still make a valley go a very pleasant place for the Christian. And so I want to look tonight, and we'll see that when we look in the valley and they had received deliverance from this bondage, we too can receive deliverance. We can find rivers of grace, rivers of mercy, rivers of pleasure. John 7:38 says, "He that cometh to me, out of his belly shall from flow rivers of living water." And so I'm here to tell you tonight, I'm here to brag on Jesus. Because of what He's done out of my belly, what Jesus has done for me, out of my belly flows rivers of joy and rivers of mercy and rivers of grace. I want to share it with you because, no, my life is not perfect. I, too, go through the valley. You go through the valley. You go through a low spot in your life, but God has never left you. He's never forsaken you. These fountains flow in the midst of the valleys. And as we look back in Psalms, and it said, He said, "For with thee," David talking about the Lord, "for with thee is the fountain of life." And so some of the greatest Christians I know have had the darkest valleys. Many have experienced the darkest valleys you find in the Bible. Number one, we see the valley of despair, of having no hope whatsoever. 2 Corinthians 1:8 says this. This is Paul speaking. Paul is in the middle of a valley. Paul has despair. You say, what is despair? Despair is having no hope. And Paul wrote this to the church at Corinth, "For we would not have you ignorant, brethren, of our trouble, that we were pressed out of measure, above strength, insomuch that we despaired even for life." Have y'all ever heard this story or heard this phrase? Well, you know God won't put on you more than you can bear. Can I just burst your bubble today? That's nowhere to be found in the Bible. Nowhere. And Paul tells us right here that it got so bad that he was pressed down beyond measure, above his strength. He was pressed down and troubled and in such despair that he wished for the day, which means he wished that he would die. Paul is the greatest preacher other than Jesus Christ in the Bible. We'll all agree, Paul's the greatest preacher to ever live on this human life. And yet he was so pressed and such in such a deep valley that he had despair and wished that his life would end. Man, have you ever been there? I can't remember a valley so deep that I've wished that I would die. I want to live as long as possible. I want to watch my kids grow. I wish they'd stop now, but I couldn't wait to have kids. Couldn't wait. I tell Britt, I can't wait to get down in the floor and play with them. Now, if I get down the floor, I can't get up, number one. But number two, now they don't want to play with Dad anymore. They got video games. They got girls and boys on their mind and different things, and now Dad just has to watch them grow. Oh, man. But you look at that and through your valley, I still want to watch those events. I want to live as long as I can. As long as the Lord allows me to live, I'm thankful for every breath He gives me. I'm thankful He woke me up this morning. And as a matter of fact, I've said it many times, I'll say it again. If God woke you up this morning, that means He's not done with you. He has something for you to do if He woke you up this morning. And so I see that, but we see the valley of despair. I've never been where Paul is. But 2 Timothy 4:16, He says, at my first answer, no man stood with me, but all men forsook me. This is Paul telling Timothy, at my first answer, no man stood with me, but all men forsook me. Notwithstanding, the Lord stood with me and strengthened me, and I was delivered out of the mouth of the lion. I'm here to tell you tonight, despair, you may be in that valley of despair, but there is a fountain that is coming for you in the middle of your valley. There is a fountain of living water, as the psalmist said, and he'll refresh you. And when you think everybody in this world has walked out on you, God will not leave you. He'll stand by you just as he did with Paul. And so we see the valley of despair. But then we see, number two, the valley of dismay. Having not only Paul had no hope, but now we come to Elijah, who had no courage. 1 Kings 19:4 says, he went a day's journey into the wilderness and sat down under a juniper tree. Now let me just give you a quick background. We see here, Kings, the Holy Spirit tells us that he went a day's journey and sat down under a juniper tree. But if you'll go read your Bible, you know what happened right before Elijah goes and sits under a juniper tree? Elijah is at his crowning moment. He's standing on Mount Carmel with all the prophets of Baal, and he laughs at them, and he jokes and asks them where their God is, and nothing happens. And then he called on the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and called fire down from heaven, and fire came and licked up the sacrifice, licked up the water, it licked up the rocks, it burnt every single thing up. He had power with God, and we still preach about it today, that Elijah's great crowning moment of calling fire down from heaven, having power with God. But then Jezebel hears about it. And Jezebel says, I'm going to kill you, Elijah. Now look, if I'm standing on Mount Carmel, you're standing on Mount Carmel, and you just call fire down from heaven from the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, would you worry about Jezebel? Would I? I would like to say I wouldn't worry about her. I'd say, God, you take... Boy, doesn't that sound real good? But you know what? It takes less than that to drive us to a place where we're in fear. We're living in fear, and we don't know where today or tomorrow's next meal will come from. So we can't judge. I'd love to sit back and say, what in the world's wrong with Elijah? But those same things happen in my life. Those many times. Can I testify? I believe you can testify the same. Has God ever failed you one time? Okay, I need an answer. Has God ever failed anybody one time? Please stand up and tell me how. No, he hasn't. All right? Never one time has God forsaken us, left us, failed us, and we ought to. Like I'm standing here in pride and in human nature, why would Elijah do that? But in that one moment where a valley comes in our life, all of a sudden we're like, God, where are you? God, why are you allowing this to happen to me? God, why am I going through this? Not realizing that all the time he's never walked out on you. He's never left you. He's never forsaken you. Why should we doubt him now? But nevertheless, we do. We doubt him. We all doubt God, and so did Elijah. And he said at a day's journey, he sat under a juniper tree and requested for himself that he might die. Well, him and Paul have a lot in common. And said, it's enough now, O Lord. Take away my life. Elijah said, I've had enough, Lord. Take my life. But God had something planned for Elijah. Can I say this? You need to watch sometimes as well how you act in your valley, because somebody's watching you. There was another young boy, and I'd never seen this until I read, and I'm not going to go deep into it tonight. There's another boy named Elisha that's following and watching Elijah. The matter of fact, after this, in this same chapter, you'll read, I never saw it, that Elijah gets fed because the fountain, as we talked about, shows up. And the Bible says that under the juniper tree, there was water at the head. He had water when he woke up there on his pallet. He had food at the feet and water at his plate. Boy, don't you know he was thirsty? Don't you know that felt good? He didn't want to die any longer? But look at this. I'd never seen this till this week, studying this. Elijah walks, and there comes out Elisha. He's been watching Elijah. And the Bible says that Elijah throws his cloak on Elisha. Now, you think that's the spirit. No, he didn't do it. He was done with the things of God for a moment. He's mad, and he throws his coat at Elisha because Elisha tries to use it, and nothing happens. You go read the rest of that story, and it gets pretty deep, but I never saw Elijah just throwing his coat. How does Elisha get the cloak later on? Remember, Elijah tells Elisha, leave. I've got to go here, but you got to leave. And Elisha said, nope, wherever you go, I'm going to go. Whatever you do, wherever you lodge, I'm going to lodge. I'm going to follow you ever. And Elijah said, why? He said, because I want a double portion of what you have. The next time Elijah goes somewhere, he says, Elisha, stay. Stay. And he said, oh, no. Nothing will satisfy me but a double portion of what you have. And then at the final, you go read the story. Elisha's caught up in a chariot, and the mantle falls down. And Elisha picks up the mantle, and when he puts it on, God uses him even greater than he used Elijah. All right? But that's not where I'd always in my life saw that, but I'd never seen Elijah mad throwing the cloak, as if throwing the power of God, throwing those things. Your kids are watching you. Your husband's watching you. Your wife's watching you. And can I just be honest? Sometimes I've thrown the cloak of the power of God just in the faces of my family and not acted like I should in the valley, when I should have been saying, God's been good. God brought us through many more, so many more before He'll bring us through this again. Your children, especially in the day and hour we living in right now, they need to hear it more and more that God is good. God will provide. God's never left us. He's never forsaken us. God's the best thing that ever happened to our family. God's the reason I have such a good wife. God's such the reason that you have a good husband. Hey, God's responsible for all of this. That's what we need to let them hear so that we could have courage. Thirdly, there's the valley of danger where we had no way. I'll go back over to one of my favorite stories, Daniel chapter 3, verse 20. Bible says Nebuchadnezzar commanded the most mighty men. Now listen, I got a hold of that too this week. The most mighty men that were in his army to bind Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego and cast them in the burning fiery furnace. I always, you know, knew he got his soldiers, but he got his mightiest, his best men. Why were those three little boys such a threat? Why did it take the mightiest of men? But the Bible says when they took Shadrach and Meshach up to the fiery furnace to cast them in, that the fire was so hot that it killed the soldiers. It killed those mightiest men of Nebuchadnezzar, but yet it didn't harm Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. When it looked like they had no way, when there was no way out, God made a way. That's why it really bugs me. It ticks me off to no end when people use another version of the Bible simply for this part of the Bible itself. When I was learning this story as a kid, and we teach it here as well, who's the fourth man in the fire? One was like unto the Son of Big G God. He's the Son of God. That's Jesus Christ in the fiery furnace in the Old Testament. Right? But all other versions say the sons, plural, of the little g gods. He wasn't a god, little g. He wasn't one of them. He is God Almighty. and he was in the fire. And if he's there, he's still in the fire. And I don't know if you're going through a valley tonight and you say, I have no way out. I'm just here to tell you, you just rejoice, because wherever you're going, God's already been there. He's going in there with you. And when you come out, he'll be walking out with you. He's waiting on you. He's with you. He'll never leave you, even in the fire. When there's no way out, the valley of danger. Number four, there's a valley of darkness, having no sight. We look at John 16 and 17. And when evening was come, his disciples went down into the sea, and entered into a ship. And it was now dark, and Jesus was not come to them. So they got on the ship without Christ. That's number one right there. Big mistake. Don't ever get in the ship without Jesus. But many times people get on their own and they're going to do everything in their life and have Jesus nowhere in the conversation. He's not even in the ship. And now it says, and by this time it's dark. It's dark when there is no sight. And the Bible says that now a storm comes up and they're in the dark and they're in a storm. But then Jesus came walking to them. Jesus came coming to them. It scared them. But then they invited him in the ship. And the Bible says when he got in the ship, all of a sudden they were at shore. You realize that even when Jesus wasn't in the ship, he was guiding the ship. Oh, you'll get that when you lay your head down tonight and say, hey, even when I don't have Jesus even invited, even when he's not in the ship, he's still guiding the ship. But oh, the peace we often forfeit. Oh, the needless pain we bear. All because we do not carry everything to Christ in prayer. You forfeit a lot of your peace and your joy, worried about everything in this world, and why not giving it to Jesus? Just give it to him. Peter said, casting all your care upon him, because he careth for you. I'm glad Jesus got in the ship with them. And in this valley of darkness, he was that water. And lastly, he'll come to us in the valley of death. He'll cause a fountain to rise up in the valley of death where there's no presence. Psalms 23:4, for thou art with me. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. We've had a lot of members die this past year. But you know what? That moment came. There wasn't a fear of death. Why? Because he was with them. He's the fountain. And I know when it's my time to come, I'll not worry. Don't you cry for me. When it's my time, I'll see you on the other side. Heaven's sounding sweeter, isn't it? Every day. I get so many calls. I got that call from my dear friend today. And she said, I want you to preach my funeral. That's tough to talk to somebody on the phone and they want you to plan their funeral. But she had the victory. She said, she even asked, she said, would it be possible to have your choir sing at the funeral? I said, I don't know how that I could arrange that, but it'd be tough, but we could sing those songs. But she said, I love your choir. They've encouraged me. She said, when I get on streaming, and she's a churchgoer now, and nothing against her church, but she said, I'd always couldn't wait to get home and get something to drink and sandwich, but I'd turn on and watch your choir. She said, I'd sit there and cry, wishing I could sing in a choir. Wish I could sing again. Wish I could play piano again. But now she has cancer all over. And she's going to pass if the Lord doesn't intervene, Miss Crystal. But nevertheless, she said, would you preach my funeral? That's the way a child of God ought to be. I had another dear former member of this church call me today while I was at the house. He said, I heard you preach Brother Keith Brown's funeral. He said, you encouraged me more than you know at a funeral. I looked at my wife and said, that's one of the top three messages I've ever heard. I said, well, thank you. He said, I want you to preach my funeral. Man, I guess my preaching's only good at funerals, because the way... As dead as church was tonight, I guess I need to change my way of preaching, I guess. Y'all are not dead yet. Y'all can shout, say amen, get alive. I know it's Wednesday night, and I know you're tired of hearing me preach. But nevertheless, you'll know him, Brother Mark McCright. We talked for a long time, and he said, I want you to preach my funeral. But he said, I'm ready to go. Whenever God calls, I'm ready. I got to thinking, I'm ready. Are you ready? The scariest thing of that valley is there's no fountain in the valley of death if you don't know Jesus. The reason there's a fountain in every single one of these valleys of despair and dismay and danger and darkness and death is because Jesus, as the psalmist said, is that living fountain. But if you're not ready, you'll have no water. You'll be like the rich man in hell lifted up his eyes and said, I'm tormented in this flame. You don't need counseling. You need Jesus. Stop playing church. Stop playing and making it all about you. It's not about you. It's about Jesus. You better give your life, your heart, everything you have to Jesus, because Jesus is coming soon. But if he doesn't come, we're going to meet him by the grave. It is appointed unto men once to die. Are you ready to meet him in the valley of death? Let's all stand. Heads bowed, eyes closed. If you're lost tonight, you can come and we'll have a lady show you, a man show you. I can show you how you can know that you are saved without a shadow of a doubt. But I'm thankful that even in the valley, God is good. God walks with us in those valleys. He is the fountain. Let's pray. Our gracious Heavenly Father, thank you for the night. I appreciate your presence. I appreciate the choir, the musicians, the people that have come out on this Wednesday night.